any further, let me just give a quick introduction. So Preeti has been in our community for close to 3 months. Am I right, Preeti?
Yeah, yes. Yes, you are okay. Right.
Yeah. And she works as an HR manager in Jiva Ayurveda. And she's been there for a long time. So she is an HR person. In fact, she's done her MBA in HR. She's a very enthusiastic member. I've known her for less than three months, actually. But I'm very impressed by her articulation, her thoughts. We've spoken quite a few times. And she's very participative in our community activities as well. She's a very interesting personality. She's got some amazing things to say. And that is why we've brought her on today. What I'm going to be doing now is handing over to Rohit, and so that I can, slide into the background. And between Rohit and Preeti, it is all yours now. I'm going to switch off my video. And Rohit, you can take over from here.
Thanks, Sudhi. So the coast is clear now. So let me pitch in. I think, Sudhi, you did, make my job a slightly easier by introducing Preeti. I think I would just like to say that that we have been living in sort of an unprecedented time, right? I think we are currently going through an uncertain situation. There is this pandemic lurking in the background, and job market is sort of up and down, I would say. Some of the industries are seeing a lot of boom, some of the industries are not doing so well. But in these uncertain times, I think what we need is a person who can guide us, right? Somebody who can actually take us through these ups and downs. And who better than an HR professional, right? So I think that is where Preeti comes in. Folklore says that you should always be friends with HR. You can make as many corporate enemies as possible, but you should always be friends with HR. And I think, having said that, I think let me bring on Preeti to kind of help us through these. Help us through these uncertain times, and kind of let's talk about some pertinent topics which are actually on our minds, right? So having said that, over to you, Preeti. I think let's hear from you briefly about your journey.
Okay, so thanks a lot, Rohit, and thanks, Sudhi, for a wonderful introduction. So with this, I would say namaskar to everyone. I hope you all are doing great and taking good care of your well-being in this pandemic time. So I'm so excited and a little nervous by sitting at this side of the table for the first time. So let me just briefly introduce myself. As by now, you all know my name. I'm Preeti, and I belong to Rajasthan and born and brought up in Delhi. I'm happily married and my husband is doing a business of water purify equipments. I'm staying in Faridabad with my husband, and I'm HR by profession, and it has been more than 13 years in HR, and I'm at a leadership position from last one decade, and my key responsibilities are managing end-to-end talent management, HR operations, and HR strategy. So these are my major responsibilities. So currently, I'm in a health industry, serving as a senior manager HR in Jiva Ayurveda. It's an Ayurveda organization, majorly dealing in Ayurveda products and medicines. And it has been more than 9 years with Jiva. And in all these 9 years, now it become, Jiva is my second family. And, the working culture in Jiva is so excellent. And the USP of Jiva is that you will work with like-minded people, with young promoters. So that is something which, make me stick to this organization that long. So I got immense learning and growth opportunity with Jiva. In fact, since beginning, I'm very health conscious. And that is one of the reasons why I'm stick to Jiva. Because again, I have introduced and, get an opportunity to work with like-minded people. And ever since I have joined Jiva, I did not remember that when I had allopathy medicine last, because be it is a cough or cold or, COVID prevention, I always go for Ayurveda medicine. And now I'm a big fan of Ayurveda. So I love keeping things organized, and I explore any and everything, which makes me super, super productive. So I love reading, dancing, and discovering new and healthy recipes. So this is my brief introduction. So over to Rohit.
Thanks, Preeti, for that introduction. So I think let's get into a slight detail of understanding what made you choose the HR as a profession. You talked about your affinity to being productive, healthy. So you understood that, but let's also understand what made you choose HR as a profession.
Okay. So, I want to be very, very honest with you, because like normal, other people, I was so confused about my career when I started my career, because initially at the initial stage of my career, I was finding myself good in communication, good in convincing people. So I thought to go somewhere in sales or marketing. In fact, when I got my first job, that was I got an offer of, both the offers. I got that I can join as a HR executive or I can join as a sales executive. But I opt for HR because, that time it was like a fantasy wherein you are working with employees, interacting with them, or it's a prestigious job, especially for females. So that was the reason which made me to join, HR domain. But when I grow up to the ladder, then I realized that HR is not all about hiring or firing people. It is beyond that. In fact, if I talk about today, so HR has to play a role of a, business partner. You have to contribute into the business. You are not the one who is just, putting the side of employee. You will have to understand the perspective and benefits of employee as well as the organization. And basis that you will have to take the decision. So over a period of time, when I realizes that it's beyond that, it is something which includes, partnering with the business, or influencing the business. Then for rationalization, wherein we have to take some tough calls, dealing with people, ask them to leave, and we have to make sure that termination should be done amicably, and manpower budgeting, making employee retention strategies, especially for critical hires, engaging alumni, those who have left the organization, that is also very, very important when it comes to employer branding. We have to have strategies, policies to engage people, those who have left the organization on good note. So such kind of activities make HR dynamic, make HR robust. So, I love my profession. And, one thing I have decided when I've chosen HR that, if I go by one profession, this profession, I would not going to change it. And this is something which was very clear to me. So I would stick to whatever I have decided since beginning. So I put my heart and soul to learn. Today I'm also learning. So I really love my profession. Yes. Yes, Rohit.
Great to know that. And I think in these uncertain times, as I said, I think the role of HR has become really important, right? So I think a follow-up question to that would be, considering what is happening right now in the country or over in the world because of the pandemic, so much uncertainty, so many people losing their jobs, some industries seeing a lot of uptick in the jobs, right? We talked about the IT industry in the couple of sessions, and we saw that there is a lot of hiring going on there. And that means that there is a lot of churn happening in the industry, be it any industry, be it IT, pharma, talk about any industry, and a lot of churn is happening, right? So what is your advice, or what would you say to people who are currently actually in the process of looking for a job, right? Either they're looking for a new job or changing their current job. What would be your advice to them?
Okay. So here I would like to say, Rohit, according to me, it's not about pandemic. In general, also, we have to be very conscious. We should not be scared of, losing job or maybe not finding any other job. It has to be there. Though I completely agree with you that, this pandemic has changed the whole game. The situation was unpredictable for all of us. So the one key which I would say that it is, keep ourselves upskilling ourselves. That is something which I always say to people, that you have to focus on gaining more and more expertise. So here I would like to add that you can also do this by I do not need to tell you that how to upskill yourself. Everybody has their own domain. They will have to go to their boss, ask to join new projects, volunteer for some new projects, enrolling themselves to some other professional courses, and maybe put ourselves in our comfort zone and take up some new responsibilities, which really make us set us apart from others. And this is something which we can do as upskilling ourselves and take new responsibilities. And we call them critical hire. When we say, if I'm talking about from HR perspectives, whenever we make any retention strategies, you always look at that who our critical hires are. So we make strategies for them. So we have to put ourselves in critical hire category. So this is something which we have to be very conscious, because if I talk about myself, I was the one initially, if somebody would ask me that, what are your three strength areas? What are your expertise? I was not very sure, of that time, because I did not realize the importance of having that skills, which makes you apart from others, which is now I'm very, very clear. So this is something which we have to be very vigilant, very conscious about what we are, how we are going ahead in our career. So I can give you one tip that how can we, be into the market, beat other people, or maybe make our stand or make our market value. So what personally worked for me is that you have to choose your I would say 3-4 words for one thing. You have to choose your enemy, you have to choose your competitor, or maybe you have to choose your ideal. So whatever works for you, you can choose it. So again, when we say competitor, somebody who is 3-4 level up from you. So for example, if I'm at a senior manager level, I would maybe look for somebody at a director, HR director level, HR CEO level, the senior most level of that domain. So I have my own competitor which I'm following right now. So first of all, you have to do complete research, wholehearted research, wherein you are finding your competitor or ideal or enemy you want to compete with. Have that attitude. Everybody has their own way to deal. So that's why I use these three terms. So here, the magic of thinking big works, because if you think about 100%, then you will get 80% or maybe 70%. So keep that thinking high, then start researching about that person, that how he grew in his career, what he reads, what he likes, what are his thoughts. Maybe you can follow him or her on LinkedIn. You can also, if that person is in reach, like for example, if in my case, two of my competitors are in my reach. So I, used to talk to them, share my ideas with them, take their advices. When you choose your competitor, you have to be very, very clear, very, very confident that, yes, this person I'm going to follow. So I'm telling you that this is something which is tried and tested. It really, really helps you. It really, really going to help you. And this is something which worked for me. And then you have to do the whole research, read the biography of that person, because in that Google world, everything is possible. You know anything and everything about anyone. And then next step is again, you have to follow him religiously, see how he grew in his career so far. So that would really, really help you to make yourself someone, or maybe it will help you to get your better version. So I think that is the key, according to me, to have a desirable market value. Yes, Rohit.
Great. All right, great. So before I ask you the next question, I can see in the chat that a few people have raised their hand. Typically like in a TV interview, I could ask my assistant to take the mic to those guys and ask their questions. But unfortunately, because we are in the Zoom meeting, I can't do that. So what I suggest is, guys, if you have any questions, you can put them in the Q&A section or either even put it in the chat. I will probably collate those questions and we can ask them to Preeti at the end, just to keep the flow of this interview going ahead. So I think a request to all to kind of put their questions in Q&A or in the chat also. I'll keep an eye on that. Okay. So Preeti, I think you talked about upskilling yourself, right? So I think another topic that actually is kind of garnering a lot of attention is about personal branding. Right. And I think in a couple of months back also, we had Sakshi Chandrakar, who talked about personal branding in great detail. Right. But in this context, I would like to know your thoughts about personal branding. How do you see it and how does it help you in your career?
Yeah. Yes, Rohit. And I completely 1000% agree that it plays significant role in the career of any profession, of any professional. So one thing which, you know, when you have mentioned Sakshi session, I have attended that session, and one thing which she mentioned, that whole quote, catched my eye, that is, jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. So you have to be skillful. We can't compromise with your competency or skills. You have to have that skills. But how would you showcase your skills? That is something which changed the entire game. So when I say personal branding, so you know, in Sakshi session, we all learn about how we do our branding in outside world. But what I personally feel is that your branding in your organization, within your circle, has to have that you have to conscious about that as well. So outside the world and inside your circle, it could be your organization, it could be with your relatives, your family members as well. So that branding should be there 360 degree. So, when I say, branding within internal organization, again, people would not understand that term much. At the junior level, it creates, maybe they would not be understand. Like Sudhi saying that, what is in it for me? Why would I be, conscious about my branding? So here, I just wanted to say that, a little example, because, when employee approaches us, for HR, employees is the customer. So we have to treat employee as a customer. But what happens is that when we look at from this, like, I have to follow this. This is my role. For example, if I would talk about HR, so HR is different domain. HR is assessment, talent acquisition team. HR is payroll team. HR is hiring team. So for example, if one employee goes to one person, because he does not know ki kaun kya karta hai, so he may go to one person and ask that, ki, okay, I want my relieving letter. I want X document. So that maybe he might have gone to recruitment team. So recruitment team may say, okay, you can go to payroll team. Payroll team will get back to you. Then payroll team is saying, no, this is not our department job. You can go to Y person. So what is making this whole thing happen? You're keeping that employee lost. You are keeping that employee dissatisfied. And eventually what that person going to say, that HR doesn't do anything. He would not take the name of that person. He say HR would not work. So here your self-branding comes. And that self-branding would make you as a whole a good team. So for example, if somebody comes, one person, and that person is not looking that particular thing, so you can anyway tell that, this is basically from that department. You can go to that person. That person is going to help you to get this. If you would not get the certain answer, you can come back to me. I will try to help you out. And in the meantime, you can call to that person that this person is coming to you for this document. Please help her out. Being a senior, if you do, then I think they would listen to you. Otherwise, they will guide you. Okay, this is happening. And okay, I'll guide to that person. Don't worry. In fact, you can do one more thing. If this person is not there, he's out of station. So you can tell that employee that you can send a mail, copy to me, and I'll make sure that this thing will get it done. So I think it would take hardly 5 minutes, but that person would remind you. That poor person would be, you will catch his attention that, okay, this person is so prompt, so concerned. Even if, for example, at any times it happens that calls lands up to HR, patients call lands up to HR. So, earlier what we used to do is like, okay, this is HR department, so you would not be able to help you. If you want to, consult a doctor, you can, you can dial this number. So generally patients say, one number is getting busy, can you please help me out? We can say, okay, try again, they will take your call. But what we are doing with this, we may lose that patient. And those who are into the business may understand that if we lose any lead, then it costs something. It costs X amount. So we're losing that X amount. And the bigger cost is that we are, making that bad employer branding, that X organization is not supported. X organization doesn't have any process. X organization employee is not supported. On the contrary, what you can do is, because obviously that patient is misguided or maybe not being able to, get the correct direction, you can tell that person if he tries again and again and he did not get the details of one doctor, you can tell him, let me take your number. Let me take your number and share with concerned department. You will get a call within 42 hours or 24 hours. Then you can share that call with the HOD of the department, because HOD of the department know that where that call has to go. And you can do one little step that you can follow up if possible, because it is just something like that. You can do on WhatsApp. कि डिड यू मेक अ कॉल टू दिस पर्सन एंड दैट HOD विल मेक श्योर ओके यस इट इज डन. सो इट्स हार्डली 5 minutes जॉब बट दैट सेव द यू नो द होल दैट द चेंज द एंटायर यू नो परस्पेक्टिव. So I think we all have to focus on our branding. So when we, you know, tell our employee that boss, it will change your game, change your image altogether. So that is something which is, you know, self-branding in your organization. And when we say personal branding outside the world, again, it is very, very important. I really do not need to reinforce this. So there are ample of, you know, platform wherein you can showcase your skills. So this LinkedIn is something which is there. And you all, you know that how to use LinkedIn, but many of you, maybe I am not sure that what is the, you know, maybe some of them are recently, you know, starting their branding themselves. So I have just quick, you know, tip for them when it comes to LinkedIn, though I'm still learning LinkedIn, but I have some tips I just wanted to quickly share with you that first of all, when it comes to putting your photographs, so you should put a you know semi-formal photograph that will you know create a great connection with other people. So this is one thing. Then when it comes to cover picture or background of the picture, you have to tell something which defines you. Okay, anything which defines you, which defines your values. So I already put it as support people to let them become their best. This is my quote. You can use whatever defines you that actually, you know, give a very, very positive impression to other people who are seeing your profile. Then when it comes to about, so you do not need to tell about your skills or something or your profile. Try to make it a little catchy, little connecting with the people. You can go to my LinkedIn profile and just see if that helps you. Then again, if you are looking for a job, then use it as a resume. Put all your skills. Apart from that, you can also, write some articles. If not write, you can read some articles, comment on them. So when you comment, sometimes people, what they do, they just like it. But you can put some comment. That when you put comment, then it shows your ideology, your viewpoint, your thought process. And if possible, I was, you know, about to come at that point, that if you can write some articles, because I've recently wrote an article. And I took Sudhi's help also. It actually changed your overall perspective. You know, I really felt very good, very, you know, I can't explain my feeling, but it was a great, great experience. So maybe some of you might be thinking, ki kya likhe hum log? Because, you know, it's not easy to write for everyone. But here, I just wanted to give you one brief or simple tip that you can, you know, have a conversation with your boss or maybe boss's boss. And try to understand their challenges, what they are, you know, challenge they are facing. Maybe you will get a couple of things and you might be knowing about some of the challenges that how to address them. In fact, you can do research as well and start writing on them. And whenever you are writing on those topics, do not miss to, you know, tag them so that they would also know that, okay, you are actually thinking about this. So I think that this is something which, you know, helped me a lot. That's why I'm sharing this idea with you. And apart from that, you should put any appreciation certificate, maybe any reward, any recognition you have received in your career so far, any other special achievement. So that would help everybody to see that how, you know, talented and capable you are. Apart from that, again, you all know that you can ask for endorsement and recommendation also with other professionals. So, you know, there is a way to do that. And last but not the least, if you are looking for a job, then one tip I have that, you know, for example, X is my dream company. Maybe you have 2-3 dream companies. You can, you know, choose the senior most person of that organization. It could be HR, it could be any other people, VP sales or marketing sales. You can send them a request. So when you send request, again, you do not need to just simply send a request. You have to send a brief note for them. It could be like, it would be an honor to be part of your community. And then you can mention your message. So that would actually make a, you know, connection since beginning. Many times they might not accept your request, but maybe some of them may accept, but if you start following up them, liking their comments, putting some comment on their articles, they will, you know, some sooner or later, they, you know, you will get the attention of that person. And yeah, so I think, you know, I think this is something which you can do to make yourself, you know, showcase your talent and, you know, brand yourself. So yes, Rohit. Yeah.
All right. Great, great. I think those were some really great tips, Preeti. So maybe after this interview, I'll go to LinkedIn and add interviewer as my skill. And I hope you can endorse me on that. So,
yeah, sure, right. Sure.
Okay. So I think let's now focus from individual to team, right? I think a lot of people here in this community are managers, right? And they have working with a lot of their subordinates and team members, right? So I think one of the important issues that is kind of troubling people is attrition, right? We are large teams and everybody has a career goal, right? And we see a lot of people coming into the team and going out of the team, and there is always a churn, right? So how do you deal with this attrition within the team, right? How do you kind of make people be with your team for a longer period of time? What are the suggestions that you can come up with for managers to keep their team happy and reduce that attrition, to keep that team stable over a longer period of time? So how would you kind of help them with this?
Yeah, so very great question from HR, you know, Rohit. So attrition is something, again, it's a very, you know, a big pain area for any of the organization, because, you know, when it comes to attrition, it is like losing those employees whom we have already invested a lot for their joining, because joining cost is there, onboarding cost is there, then training cost is there, and somebody who is already trained, maybe leaving after, you know, spending a couple of years, then it's a big loss because you have invested too much time on that person. So that costs you a lot. So again, as I mentioned, that we make a separate strategies for them who I have recently joined the organization. So whom we call critical hire. We have a separate policy how to retain critical hires, because when somebody is not performing well and leave, may not pinches a lot as compared to when somebody who is already performing well, you know, contributing in a such a great extent would leave. So we have make strategies in a way that we make sure that from a performing team, nobody shouldn't leave. So this is one thing. And secondly, there is one thing we all should know, and maybe some of you might be knowing, that whenever any employee leave, he never leave the organization. He never leaves the organization, he leave the manager. He leaves the manager. So we always have to focus on how our managers are dealing with their team. So this is the key. So when, you know, whenever we have a separate, you know, a process wherein we train our first time managers, those who have just promoted as a manager, because managing a team is a different skill altogether. You might be a good performer as in an IC role, as an individual, but when it comes to managing a team, boss, you will have to have something else. You have to be more on your soft skills versus your technical skills. So we always focus on that and give a training to managers on this timely. And as I already mentioned, I wrote an article on how to manage team effectively. You can go and check that article. That will help you to some extent. As HR, we actually, you know, do handholding, not at the time of, you know, onboarding only. We do it for 6 to 7 months, because that is the, you know, a teething period, I would say, for new employees who have recently joined. So they need our special attention. So we majorly focus on those who are performing excellent. And it's not that we are not focusing on another, but these are our, because we have to target that we have what we, you know, make us big loss. So those who have recently joined, because they need our help, they need direction. So we do 30, 60, 90. So these are the touch points when we touch them with certain agenda. So this is the way by, you know, we basically keep them engaged with us. Apart from that, a couple of things which you can do when, you know, this is something which I personally felt that, you know, what we do is we basically take a critical decision. When we are working on any project, we talk to our seniors, we talk to our managers, we do a board of, you know, meetings and decide something and then communicate to our team. though our team is little is very sincere and they will do whatever direction you give them, they will follow all these direction. But what I would say is that we have to change this perspective a little bit, wherein why don't we involve them day one when it comes to taking decisions, making that project executed. For example, we were making a project which called Idea Lab. So we were, so when we Idea Lab is something like empowering our employees to give some ideas, good ideas, share with us, which is going to help in our business, in our services. So we had a meeting with the whole team that how you want this whole project to be executed. So, some of them would give us little, maybe not very impressive idea, but some of them came up with excellent ideas. And you know what happens is when you take these ideas, which are suggested by your team member, they take full accountability of get that idea successful. And let me tell you that they would start surprising you once you will start this process, that taking these decisions, executing programs so well. So, here I want to add one more thing, that everybody, because people are saying, ki, achha, aap salary bada do, because many of the people are working for salary, ab salary nahi milegi, unhe achhi to, why would they work? So here I want to mention that everybody is not working for salary. You have seen so many organizations, they are paymaster, but still their attrition rate is so high. So sometimes, little motivation, growth path, learning opportunities are play important role. In fact, there are some zero cost activities you can do for your employees, which is R&R activity, reward and recognition activities. We have recently started R&R executive for our junior most employees, because earlier that departments were neglected, because we can easily replace them. But they are also contributing one the other way. We have to think about them. So we have started reward and recognition activity for them, which I think zero cost. We have to just announce their name, give them certificate by the director of the company, showcase their names to all other employees, that changed the whole game. So I think that these small things we all have to do, and that will change the entire game. Yeah, Rohit. Sure. Yes.
Okay, great. So I think then flipping the role, I think coming out of the manager's shoes and going into, say for example, an employee's shoes, I think one of the things that motivates people, or at least increases their interest, is the appraisal period, right? I think as the appraisals come close, I think there is a lot of hectic activity going on the floor, and that is what interests a lot of people. So can you share any ideas on how do you conduct yourself during the appraisal period? What is it that you should do to kind of get a good appraisal and get a good recognition for the work that you have done? So because appraisal is not something which is short term, it's sort of a long term, right? It looks at your performance throughout the year. So how do I, as a probably an employee, make the best out of the appraisal?
Okay. So, when it comes to appraisal, again, we get, it may be a different process, different way of communicating or dealing or perceiving for, individuals. It is basically depend upon individual to individual. But I would start this, question by saying that you do not get what you deserve. You get what you negotiate for. Okay, because what happens is that we feel like, okay, I'm performing well, because this is something which I've been doing in initial stage of my career. I'm doing very well. I've been appreciated by my manager. I finish my task in time, so I would be getting what my manager knows that I'm performing well, so he will give me the best. Okay, and we never come up with our expectation. So this is something, the biggest mistake we do. So I think you should know how to negotiate. So when it comes to appraisal, I would not say that you should start negotiating. So I think that this is something which you start even before, maybe 6-7 months or maybe a year before. Go to your manager, ask your manager that what you want, what is your expectation. You can ask your manager that what is your expectation from me, what do you want me to done. Please let me know this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 things which you want me to finish or done. maybe you might would not finish all of them, maybe not perform well as per his expectation, but trust me, there are very, very less employers who go and discuss such things, go and ask for responsibilities, go and volunteer for responsibilities. You know, that day you would get a special attention from your manager. Okay, this is the one who actually wants to do something. If possible, if it is allowed, then you can tell them that, see, boss, I am ready to put my heart and soul. I can stay back and do whatever you want to do. If possible, then you can say this also. But I will do whatever you want, but then you have to do what is my expectation. So this expectation should not be discussed at the time of appraisal table. It has to be discussed before. Okay, this is one thing we all should understand. Then when it comes to negotiation, if you are so sure that you have done well, you have performed well, you went out of the box and tried to live up to the expectation of the manager, everybody is liking your words. There is no harm to put your expectation forward. They may laugh. Maybe you, when you say that, I want this position, I want this much hike, they may laugh. But I think it's better than, saying nothing about anything and letting them assume that what you want. This is something which is, I think, maybe make the whole scenario a little easy. And when it comes to, putting expectation, as I mentioned, that when you say, for example, I am looking for X hike. So put it a little reasonable, not too high and not too low, because both is risky. So try to put something reasonable. If you are expecting 40% or 30% hike, you can tell them, boss, I'm looking for 50% hike. Because of these many reasons, put them with so much confidence, that would, again, maybe they might not understand your request that time, but if you're expecting 50, maybe it would conclude at 35 or maybe 30%. So it would be a little close to them. But again, I think this should be an agenda. I don't know how your manager is, but that the way you perceive this, conduct this conversation, that would change your personality in front of your manager. Because you know what happens recently, there is one member of my team managed by two managers, one person was the one who's saying that, okay, we have to promote this person, and the second manager was saying that, no, I don't want to promote this person because I did not like his job. So because what happened, because that person did not ask for any promotion, So the other person was asking, like, why are you so pushy about his promotion? Because he himself is not looking for any promotion. So why are you so fussy? So what I'm trying to say is there. This is something which is very weak from the point of that person who is from the point of view of appraisees. Because appraisee has to be very clear what he wants, because that make that whole conversation a little weakened. This conversation is still going on, but what I'm trying to say is that you have to be very, at this stage, you have to be a little demanding, be clear what you want and put your point with so much confidence. And again, as I mentioned, that put yourself in critical higher category, make yourself irreplaceable so that people want you. This is something which you have to do. So, yeah.
Thanks. I think we are having an awesome conversation, and I have got a laundry list of questions with me, but I think it's time for a commercial break. I think we should go back to our sponsors. So Sudhi, how are we doing on time? Should I continue? I have got a big list. Sudhi, are you there? Okay. If Sudhi doesn't respond, we'll end the commercial break quickly and I'll ask you the next question. Okay, I think I'm not hearing back from Sudhi. So I'll go back to the next question. So I think, Preeti, at the start you mentioned that you love to be super productive, right? I think this term super productive is really attractive, right? And everybody wants to be super productive. But tell us, I think, what is it, what do you do to be super productive? What does it mean to you to be super productive, right? And maybe you can share some examples. How do you stay highly motivated? How are you super productive? And if I were your manager, I think I would be really happy to see you super productive. So what is actually being super productive is?
Okay. So here, Rohit, I would say very simple things. Again, I would share my examples with you. Super productive means that I think one thing we all should understand that you have to have a discipline in your life. So when I say discipline, I think it starts with if you make some routine. So I think you should make some morning and evening routine. So when you make your routine and stick to that, so again, you will start moving towards that productivity. And, you have to have bigger goal. That's great. But how to achieve them, you have to have that, you know, plan for that. So you can have bigger goal in your life, but break them in a small goal and work towards the system of achieving those goals, not just randomly write that, okay, I want to be this and that. You have to have a small goal, small steps towards that, and a system around that. For example, if I say that I want to be HR director after XYZ years down the line, then there must be small step that am I supposed to do? I should start reading some HR articles. I should writing some HR related articles. I have to make contacts with senior people in the industry. I have to, involve myself in more HR strategic decision. So do some research and, research activities like other competitors are doing. Doing some self-branding activities, then start working towards these small goals. So I think this makes the whole difference when you, work on small things, okay? And I highly recommend that you should follow or pursue your one hobby, because maybe you are saying hobby, if you pursue one hobby, that give you a different kind of motivation, relaxation, or if I say that your me time, your self-love time. So for example, I love dancing, but I do not have time to, dance. Obviously my schedule is too busy. So sometimes I replace my workout with dancing. That's why I do it. In fact, you can also, if you want to do too many activity, for example, I love reading. So what I do is I include reading with whenever I have my morning drink. So I read until my morning drink finishes. So be it for 15 or 10 minutes read, but I do it daily and consistently. So here my next point comes that, do what you mean what you say. That, make you super confident when you know, if I committed myself, I'm going to do this, then I'm starting this activities. If I'm not going to pursue that, I would not even start this activity. So if you mean, then you commit, and what you have committed, you have to mean it. So again, sure. This, that boost up your self-confidence. And one more thing I would say that, we have to take the accountability of our life. Nobody else is accountable, responsible for our success and for our failure. So we have to be, I think there is one, I don't know, you might have heard about this formula that this it's called event plus response is outcome. So we have to control our response on every event. And trust me, the outcome of your life would change. So how you are responding on small activities or things happening in your life, the whole outcome of your life would change. So this is one thing. So it is completely up to you that do you really want to crib for whatever you do not have, or you really want to make most out of what all you have. So this is something which is, I always keep in my mind. And last but not the least, take action, 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 and action. So there is one phrase that one is better than none. So, go for it. Maybe it would not be excellent, or what would worst happen? You may fail, but you know that failure would also give you some learning. And again, we all are, in the world of learning and learning and learning. So take action. Yeah. We have to focus on.
Perfect. Yes. Great. Thanks, Preeti. So I think let's take a question from the audience at this stage. I think the first question that we get here is, nowadays the recruitment cycle is significantly more. Any specific reasons for that, and how can it be reduced?
Recruitment cycle.
Yeah, the recruitment cycle is significantly more these days.
Okay, so you are saying that we have to, how we cut down the recruitment process?
Yeah, I think probably the member wants to ask about the time period for the recruitment, right? I mean, right from the time when the job is posted till the time the entire cycle completes, I think there is a long period that is there in that recruitment cycle. So how can it be reduced, and what is the reason behind it being so long?
So for that, I think that we have to understand that what kind of hiring is going on. It is all depend upon the type of hiring. So again, if you feel like the hiring period is going higher or maybe long, then you can have a discussion internally with your management, with your team, and try to figure out that what all the rounds or maybe, process which can be skipped. So if I talk about my organization, we have maximum 3 rounds. One is from the technical team, one is from operation teams, and one is the final round of HR. And if we stuck in any of these 3 rounds, or maybe two rounds says one common thing and one is a different, then we take the opinion of HODs. That's how we try to, complete the entire process in maximum 2 hours when it comes to bulk hiring. So I think this is basically the solution would be that you have to discuss with your manager what all processes are involved and try to skip those processes which are irrelevant. Yeah, I think that would be the answer. Yeah.
Thanks, Priti, for answering this. There's another question, which is quite an interesting question. They want to know, how do you measure a manager's performance in terms of people management?
Manager's performance
when it comes to people management.
Okay. So in that case, you can do a couple of things. Obviously, when you work with any manager, you get a feedback with the team. So what we basically do is when it comes to managing team, so we do, again, just as I mentioned, that we do touch point meetings. So we generally do meeting with their teams, make them feel empowered. And we do meeting 30 days, 90 days, or 60 days. This meeting is basically to know their 360-degree perspective. And that meetings includes that how supportive your manager is. So we do not ask this question directly. We basically ask some leading questions which say that, okay, and we feel that you are getting, complete support with your manager. And we hope that your manager is, sorting out all your queries. He's always there to support you. So these are some leading questions we ask them positively. And, our main agenda is to make everyone empowered. And if we get any maybe negative feedback, or maximum, if we have to see the majority here. So basis that we get the feedback. And when you work with the people, being in HR, when we see the attrition and, when we meet with their team members. So that's help us to know about that manager, that how he's managing his team.
Okay. So basically you're saying that you go for a 360-degree cycle, right? Something yes. that Sudhir talked about in one of the sessions, right? You go for Absolutely. A 360-degree cycle where you get feedback for the manager from other folks also, and that's how you actually get to understand whether the manager is competent in doing his job or not, right? Okay, it's interesting.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. So I'll go back to the sponsor once again. Sudhi, are you there now? How are we doing on time? I think we have already crossed the limit. I think it was a great conversation that we were having. So I think it's time to check with you.
Yeah, no problem, Rohit. If you still have some questions, we have allowance to go until 9:30.
Well, if you give me that liberty, I have got loads of questions. I mean, we can go on.
So maybe one or two more questions and that should be.
Sure. So here goes, Priti. I think I'll ask you another question. As a manager, how do you help the people to grow professionally and personally, right? I mean, we were talking about in a corporate setting, right? Doing your job is the first and foremost thing that you do. But if I'm a manager and I want my people to grow professionally as well as personally also, I want to see them become good folks over a larger period of time. So how do I actually do that? How do I invest in my folks?
So, I'm at a leadership position and, if you ask me that how I manage my team, again, this is very close to my heart. And the first, key of managing your team, that you manage your team the way you want to manage yourself. So this is something which, I always keep in my mind. Whenever I take any decision, I always see that how I want to be managed. So this is one thing. And I am always firm believer of delegating responsibilities, but with the authorities, because once we give the responsibility but do not give any authority, then maybe your game will not work that well. There is no fun. So I always try to give responsibilities, give them authorities, and oversee that how they are doing. So that works wonders. And again, when it comes to taking critical decision, I always, always try to involve them from day one and try to make sure that they are giving me some solutions and then try to pick some of them and ask them to execute. So this is one thing. And again, you know, personal connection is also works pretty well. Do not involve too much, but yeah, have to have that personal connection, have that jolly nature with your team so that what I'm trying to say that you have to make yourself available for them. They can come to you, share their problem where they should never feel like, okay, she's not going to listen to me. You have to make yourself available, have to have personal rapport with them. And if get time, then try to ask their personal well-being as well. And this is something, this is very small, small things, but you know, again, create wonders. I also try to, you know, understand their expectation when it comes to training. So we always, you know, focus what are their training areas. We have the different sessions for them to understand what they want to learn further. And basis their competency, we give them new responsibilities as well. And again, I never wait for appraisal interviews. I do midterm reviews, which is nothing to do with appraisal, but this is basically helps to set the clear expectation. What is my expectation from you? And you tell me what is your expectation from me. So that transparency should be there. Again, too many other things about leadership I have mentioned in my article, which is there on LinkedIn. People can go and check that out. And I also share my learning with them. So whatever new things I learn, I actually, you know, start feeling uneasy until I, you know, not share my learning with my team. So I keep, you know, telling them what all I have learned in one or the other way. So these are some things which I do to, you know, be as a good leader. I hope I'm a good leader. Yeah.
No, absolutely. I think some really great tips, I guess, Preeti. I think some of things that you said, I think I have also tried them with my team members. I think, as you said, I think developing that rapport with people is absolutely important. Unless you develop that rapport, I think you will not come across as an earnest person, right? I think you have to kind of empathize with your folks and make sure that they also feel that you are here to kind of help them grow personally and professionally both. So I think in order to do that, I think creating that rapport is really very important. I think I place that right at the top of my list when it comes to dealing with people. So yeah, I think some great insights.
In fact, right. You know, you asked me about that appraisal question. So I just wanted to add one more thing, like, you know, those at a senior level and might not be getting another level little. So, you know, for example, you are at a manager level and looking for AVP level, VPB level or senior manager level. Here, I want to add one thing that, you know, when you have started your career, when you start your career, so getting promotion is little easy for you because, you know, that time your employer look towards your technical skills. Okay. But when you grow in your career, reaches at the manager level and above, then, you know, that technical take little backseat and your soft skill, people management, taking critical feedbacks positively and people management, conflict management, and how you are perceiving yourself, how you are communicating, how good influencer you are. That is, you know, takes time. So, you know, it comes, the technical is something which you learn, you know, by taking some programs, taking some training. But when it comes to soft skills, it comes with time. You know, you have to experience too many things. Sometimes you have to fail. Sometimes you have to experience. So have some patience. If you reach at the manager level or maybe at senior manager level, it will take some time to reach to next level. Maybe it would take 2 to 3 years. But do not, you know, make yourself demotivated. Do not feel like, okay, you are not, maybe you are lacking behind or something like that. No, this is my personal experience. And I'm saying with this, with my experience, you have to just focus on building and sharpening up your soft skills. Yeah.
True. Thanks. You have spoken like a true real leader, Preeti. Thanks a lot for sharing your insight. I think it has been an engaging session. I think you were to the point when it came to kind of talking about all these topics from an HR perspective. So I think thanks a lot for sharing all so many insights on these things. And I hope, I think the audience has also taken a few points from this conversation and hope it helps them in the longer run. So thanks a lot.